Back to the Jaco Report. The new majority in the House of Representatives is vowing to issue subpoenas and investigate what some of them call the fraud of global warming science. Among climate change skeptics is Collinsville Republican Congressman John Shimkus. This week, the congressman asked fellow Republicans to make him the new chairman of the House Energy and Commerce Committee, a committee that deals with a lot of climate-related legislation. In March of 2009, Congressman Shimkus linked global warming and God in this session of a House subcommittee on the energy and the environment.
The right of free speech is a great right that we have in this country. Very few times we use it to espouse our theological or religious beliefs, but we do have members of the clergy here as members of the panel. So I want to start with Genesis 8, verse 21 and 22. Never again will I curse the ground because of man, even though every inclination of his heart is evil from childhood, and never again will I destroy all living creatures as I have done. As long as the earth endures, seed time and harvest, cold and heat, summer and winter, day and night will never cease. I believe that's the infallible word of God, and that's the way it's going to be for his creation. The second verse comes from Matthew 24. And he will send his angels with a loud trumpet call, and they will gather his elect from the four winds, from one end of the heavens to the other. The earth will end only when God declares it's time to be over. Man will not destroy this earth. This earth will not be destroyed by a flood. And I appreciate having panelists here who are men of faith, and we can get into the theological discourse of that position, but I do believe God's word is infallible, unchanging, perfect. Two other issues, Mr. Chairman. Today we have about 388 parts per million in the atmosphere. I think in the age of the dinosaurs where we had most flora and fauna, we were probably at 4,000 parts per million. There is a theological debate that this is a carbon-starved planet, not too much carbon.
Joining us now by satellite from Washington, D.C. is Congressman John Shimkus. Congressman, good to see you again. Thank you for joining us.
Well, thanks for having me over this long airways here.
You said that your comments back in 2009 about Genesis and the book of Matthew and climate change were taken out of context. In what way?
Well, all I've said was that you have to know the context of the hearing. The hearing was on climate change. There were two theologians on the panel. They had presented testimony, written testimony, using scripture. I just wanted to make sure that folks know there were other scripture references that really would address the issue of the destruction of the earth. And, you know, the climate change cadre, you know, want the American people and the world to believe that the world is going to be destroyed. And I reject that premise.
So do you think scripture is a real basis on which to base a critique of climate change science?
Well, I do not mind people questioning my belief in scripture. Those of us of every faith who hold dear to their faith should stand firm on the doctrines they believe in. And if those folks want to attack that is their right.
So I'm still trying to figure out what from a theological point of view, this has to do with the science of global warming and climate change and disputes over the science. Does it have anything to do with it?
Yeah, well, it really doesn't. I mean, that's why this is kind of all the climate change debate is based upon a premise that the Earth is going to be destroyed. You know, I believe as a Christian by faith that the evolution, the growth, the development, the creation of the world was by God's hand, and God will, at that time, when the end time comes, that'll be at God's hand. It's not going to be based upon some faulty premise of carbon dioxide melting all the glaciers and flooding the earth. Of course, that's the Genesis story.
Okay, well, let's talk about that for a minute. You've asked your Republican colleagues to make you chairman of the House Energy and Commerce Committee, which would have something to do in a lot of ways with a lot of any climate legislation that would work its way through the House.
Well, there's not going to be any climate legislation. I think that for people to believe that there would be, especially with the changes in this legislative process, the vast majority of Democrats who were defeated in this cycle were fossil fuel Democrats who held the party line on climate change and the attack on fossil fuel. Harry Reid said yesterday, no climate change legislation even out of the Senate in the next Congress.
Now, so let me get this straight. You do not believe that, number one, the Earth's climate is changing, or is it that you believe it's changing, but that nothing?
You've done due diligence. You know that my statements are that I visited Greenland just a couple months ago. The climate is changing. The question is a cost-benefit analysis of costing jobs, raising energy prices to stop something you can't stop, versus using money to mitigate the effects of climate change. Even if you believe in evolution, the climate has changed throughout the history of this Earth, and it's going to continue. To think that man can control the world's temperature, I find very arrogant.
All right, so let's talk about that. When you talk about mitigating climate change instead of trying to prevent something that's unpreventable, mitigating it, do you have any specifics in mind?
Well, first of all, there are people who are right now hoping that there's a new Northwest Passage so that they can easily move cargo from Asia to Europe through the Northwest Passage. We also have the nations who border the Arctic Circle already looking at oil and gas recovery under the Arctic Circle. You have Greenland, who, you know, is happy to receive tourists and is able to grow their own vegetables. So for every person who thinks climate change is terrible, there are those who are ready to deal and adapt with the changes that have occurred throughout the history of the Earth.
Do you think part of that, as a lot of climate science, in fact, as most climate science believes, is going to be the flooding of coastal areas? And what, if anything, could be done to mitigate that?
Yeah, I think the question is glacier melt, how much, what is the sea rise? The science is not exact on whether it be 6 foot or an inch or a quarter inch. Again, throughout the history in the St. Louis metropolitan area, why do we have the Great Plains? It's because there was a glacier there. A glacier moved down out of Canada. It filled all of North America. It made the Great Plains, and then it receded. This is stuff that has always gone on. Again, for man to think that we can micromanage and through our own power stop climate from changing is, again, the height of arrogance.
Your colleague, Congressman Darrell Issa, has said when he becomes chair of House Oversight, the first thing he's going to do is start issuing subpoenas about what he considers some malfeasance in the scientific community regarding climate change. The folks at the American Geophysical Union this week have said that amounts to sort of a fatwa, a jihad declared against science. How do you feel about that?
Well, all I know is that I followed this, Charles, as you know, the International Panel on Climate Change. We know about them jimming the numbers, and we know the emails and their statements saying, hey, this science doesn't look good for us. We're going to have to do this. I think the science committee today is holding a hearing just to get the facts on the table. Let's get the facts on the table. Let's not try to use our own personal values to direct the science to prove that. I mean, the whole scientific theory. All we're asking is for the scientific theory to be presented. And it is a theory. A theory is defined as an educated guess. And until they do that, it is not proven.
So do you, if the American Geophysical Union calls this, quote, a witch hunt, you would respond?
Well, we're not in the majority. Darrell Issa is not the chairman. Let's deal with that if and when that happens.
Congressman John Shimkus from Illinois' 19th District in the Metro East. Congressman, a pleasure as always. Thank you very much for being with us, sir.
Thank you.
When we return, a Washington University climate scientist talks about his fear that there is a war being waged on science in general and climate science in particular. Stay with us, please. The Jacob Report will be right back.